بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is the seventh video, Communication Skills for Physicians, a DVD course by the Saudi Commission for Health Specialties. This is Dr. Faisal Reis with you. I'm going to cover in this video three steps of doctor-patient relationship. We are going to cover how to build rapport, how to show our patient our empathy, and how to make use of the physical examination. Okay? Step 3, 4, and 5. Okay, let us start with building rapport. This is the skills of building rapport. Show patient interest and respect. Show support and care. Recognize verbal cues and non-verbal cues, and respond immediately to patient cues. Balance between intimate relationship and professional relationship, flexibility and respect of patient autonomy, confidence, show patient you are confident, non-judgmental attitude, confidentiality, and building rapport with the family. Let us take them one by one. What do you mean by rapport? Rapport occurs when patient and doctor feel they relate well to each other. Relate well. The relation is not normal. It's very strong. We call it intimate relationship. علاقة ودية. Intimate relationship. Steps of building rapport. First, show interest and respect. Try to take the opportunity anytime during the consultation to show patient how much you respect him. How much you are interested about him by continuing eye contact, by continuing encouragement. Okay. Second skill is to show support and care. Whenever patient tell you something, you show him you are with him. For example, like you tell him, you are right. I will see what can I do for you. All these supporting comments and show how much you care for him. Number three, to recognize patient cues. Either verbally or non-verbally. If, for example, you notice any facial expression that he is sad, you tell him that you are noticing this. If he tell you a vague word, for example, you ask him, how are you? He will tell you, ماشي الحال. He will tell you, not bad. Try to elaborate more. What do you mean by not bad? And respond immediately to patient cue. Don't leave it to the end, because this cues, it means that the patient has emotion here. The patient has psychosocial problem. He likes to ventilate. He likes to talk about it. Some doctors, they prefer to leave it at the end. It's not good doctor-patient relationship. It is not good communication. To practice good doctor-patient relationship, we need to immediately to react to it and appropriately to react to it. So postponing the response to patient's cues will give negative message to the patient. He will say, doctor is not interested, so I will not tell him again. I will not show him again my feelings. Okay? Five, to balance between the intimate relationship and professional relationship. You need to know that you are not patient friends or patient relatives, so you need to keep the red line of your professional image. Why you need to keep this red line? The advantage of this balancing in the relationship to prevent dependency, so the patient will not be over dependent on you. It is better use of time in the consultation, so you will concentrate on the relevant things. When we encourage you to pay attention to the patient's psychosocial problems, we mean the real psychosocial problem, but not the detailed personal things. Okay? And another reason, this professional relationship, it will encourage patient to talk more freely. He will talk to you because you are professional. You can understand him. So keep this red line of your professional image. Building rapport skills is flexibility and respect of patient autonomy. What do you mean by patient autonomy? The patient tried to choose for himself. So if a patient, he think this option is better for him, but you as a doctor, you don't think it is the best option for him, you want to balance between losing the relationship or to be flexible and respect his wish, his autonomy. What do you choose? Are you going to be very rigid and to insist of your choice, or you respect his autonomy and to go with his with the patient's choice? Taking into consideration there is no real risk of choosing A or B. It is controversial things. So if you are talking about controversial things, we should respect patient autonomy. We should respect patient choice. If you choose to do something, even if it is not our preferable choice, we should respect his choice and to be flexible. And to consider the relationship, priority number one. Okay? And in any argument, try to avoid rigidity and to consider maintaining the relationship with your patient, as I said, priority number one. For example, I'll give you another example. If, for example, your patient insists of certain investigation, and you may think it is not really necessarily, but the patient insists, and he will go and complain to the everywhere. Newspaper to complain to your boss why you are not helping him, why you are not doing this investigation for him. You need to make a balance. Is it okay to lose the relationship with this patient? Or this investigation is not necessary, but it's not very harmful, it's not very costly. Why don't we do it? Sometimes we respect patient autonomy, even if it is not our choice, taking into consideration it's not going to harm him, it's not going to cost the health services much, because we consider our relationship with our patient priority number one. So we need to be flexible, not to be rigid. Okay? Try always to use this magical word. What do you think? Ish rayak. What do you think? It is very magical. It makes the patient feel that he is respected, that he has a choice in his health. What do you think? Okay? Show understanding to a patient point of view. Number seven, show confidence. Your patient like to picture you confident enough and skillful enough. So you need to show him how confident you are. You need to work on your credibility. And we talk in communication skills, the different classification of nonverbal communication, including the clinic arrangement, including the environment of your clinic, including your appearance, including your the way you talk, all these things, it to reflect your confidence and your credibility. You should work on this, your tone of voice, your building rapport. Number eight, non-judgmental attitude. Remember that the patient is a patient. He is weak and he need your help. So try to understand the situation instead of blaming and shaming. For example, if a patient, you advise him about diet, and he's diabetic, and he come to you with very high blood sugar, and he come to you, instead of losing weight, he gain weight. Try to understand why he is doing this instead of blaming and shaming. He is a patient. For sure, he has his excuses. Confidentiality. If needed, if patient, for example, you feel that he has something he wants to tell, but he feel hesitant to tell it, remind him that everything between you and him is confidential. So this will help to make him have a good relationship with you, and he will ventilate even his deep secrets. Number 10, building rapport with the family. Some of you will say, why family? It's too much. Why we are saying this? Whenever possible, when a patient comes to you with any relative with him, you should consider this relative very important. He is the consultant for him, why he is coming. Could be the wife, could be the son, could be the mother, whoever accompanied the patient. Try to talk to him, try to let him take your side. So when you give any recommendation, in the management, try to direct your advice or your explanation to both of them, to the patient and to the company. Okay? And try to show your respect to him or to her, to let him take your side instead of giving advice contradictory to your advice. Because if he is not convinced, he will advise your patient contradictory advice to your advice. Okay? So try from the start to let him take your side and to complement your advice, to work with you instead of working against you. Okay? Use it or lose it. The smart doctor, he uses it. Okay? Let us see what is the myth and what are the truth about building rapport with the patient, to having special relationship with the patient. Some doctors, they may say rapport is against professionalism. I should have very clear red lines between me and the patient. This is some doctor understand about professionalism. But the truth, rapport is one of the patient's rights. He needs to be treated as special because he's telling you all his secrets, consider you very trustful. You need to treat him as special as well, okay? And the other things, we ask you to have balance between the intimate and professional relationship. And the smart doctor, they know where to put the red lines, how to balance between the intimate and professional relationship. Rapport with the family. Oh, I'm not a social worker to communicate with the family. It's enough for me to communicate with the patient. But involving the family will improve the compliance. One of your aim is when you give any instruction to the patient or any medication, you want him to comply with you. If he didn't comply with you, so all your effort, it's useless. So if rapport with the family, it make compliance better, why don't you do it? It will improve your satisfaction if the patient is comply with your advice or your instruction, whatever it is. It will improve your self-satisfaction. And it will reduce doctor shopping. So instead of this family member who's accompanying the patient, taking the opposite role of your advice and advise against you, if you make him taking your side, so the patient will not go from you to another doctor and he continue shopping. That's it for building rapport. Okay, we move now to the step 4, empathy. Empathy is very much needed by every patient when he comes to tell us about his symptom, his psychosocial suffering with this symptom. He needs our empathy. How to show our patient our empathy? It's very simple, very easy. Remember by this letter NURSE, N-U-R-S-E, NURSE, okay? Name the emotion, show understanding, respect and no criticism, show your support and help the patient to explore his emotion. And we will see how to do it. I will give you an example in Arabic language. For example, you tell him, let us say the patient has backache. Okay? Name the emotion. شكلك منزعج من آلام الظهر. Okay? Show understanding. آلام الظهر بالفعل مزعجة. طيب؟ You show him that you understand that his backache is annoying. Show respect and no criticism. أنا تفهم ومقدر معاناتك. Okay? تبدو منزعجة من آلام الظهر. آلام الظهر بالفعل شيء مزعج. أنا متفهم ومقدر لمعاناتك. Okay? Show support. لكن بإذن الله سنجد حلا. Okay? And exploration of feeling and facilitation. Because you recognize that the patient has feelings, you ask him to elaborate more, to explore more about his feelings. You ask him, كلمني أكثر. كيف حاسس؟ Okay? It's very easy, very simple. شكلك منزعج من آلام الظهر. معك حق، آلام الظهر مزعجة. أنا متفهم ومقدر معاناتك. بإذن الله حنلاقي حل. تحب تكلمني أكثر عن مشاعرك؟ كيف حاسس؟ okay, with a mirroring voice, with non-verbal communication, show that you are empathizing with your patient. Okay? And we will see this in the role play, inshallah. Here I want to emphasize that to empathize with the patient, it's not necessarily the patient, he will tell you, has psychosocial component with his physical problem. He will tell you he has a big problem with his wife, or a big problem at work, or he is very depressed. Any symptom which necessitates the patient to come to you, this is a psychosocial component of patient problem. Because he came to you, he couldn't go to work, he has a problem at home, he can't manage appropriately, he couldn't do his ordinary activity. This is a psychosocial component of patient problem. He doesn't need to be very depressed, he doesn't need to have a big problem at work or at home. So, for any complaint, whatever it is, we need to show our empathy, okay? As I told you, patient has a back pain. Patient is not having depression, he has a back pain. So you emphasize with this back pain which caused him this disturbance, okay? What are the non-empathic response or destructive comment? Some doctor, they may do it. They may do it with good intention, but it is destructive, really. Changing the topics. For example, the patient, he tell you, I have severe back pain, and I couldn't sleep last night from this back pain. And he want to continue complaining about he couldn't sleep. You redirect him, let us focus on your back pain. As if his suffering, he couldn't sleep, is not important. This is very destructive comment and make the patient feel that you are not empathic with. Okay? The second destructive comment, some doctor, they may do it. I know better than you. I give you an example. For example, the patient tell you, I have severe back pain. I couldn't sleep last night. I'm very worried it might be something very serious. So the doctor reply, don't worry. I am your doctor. Believe me, it is nothing. It's not serious. Okay? Do you think this is helping? Do you think this is empathic response? No, it's not. Although the intention is positive, doctor want to help his patient, want to reassure him, but to block the patient like this, not to let him complete his worry, and not to show respect to what he think that it is serious, from the start it is not helping at all. It's not empathic response. Number three of destructive comment, judgmental response. For example, the patient tell you, I have severe back pain, I couldn't sleep last night, I'm very worried it might be something serious. You are telling him, no, you are overreacting. Every day I see patient like this, don't worry. Although the doctor, again, he's saying this with good intention, but for the patient to tell him you are overreacting as if you are insulting him, as if he is lying or he is obsessional. So, better not to use such judgmental comment. Other destructive comments, for example, giving advice very early in the consultation, before the patient ventilate or his feelings or his worry. Whenever he tell you, for example, again with the patient, the back pain, he will tell you, I have a back pain, severe back pain, I couldn't sleep last night, I'm worried that it might be serious. So the doctor start advising him, don't worry, if you couldn't sleep, no problem, next time do this and this. So such advice before you let the patient ventilate all his feelings, it is a destructive comment. As if you are sending a message to the patient, stop it. Don't complain anymore. Okay, premature reassurance. And we talk about premature reassurance before, to tell the patient, it's nothing, it's minor. Every day I see a lot of patients like this. It is insulting as well. Interrogating questions. For example, the patient wants to talk about his worry and his suffering. Last night he couldn't sleep. and you are giving him direct questions to his physical part of the problem. Okay, it is your business. It is to take the detail of the physical part of the problem, but you need to give the patient chance to ventilate his feeling first, because such concentration on physical part, as we are saying this from the start of the this course, and we continue saying this, it is not helping to the patient. Okay, telling your own story. This is not uncommon, really. Patient come complaining of something, and you, instead of let him continue to ventilate his suffering, you tell him what's your problem. For example, let us with our take the first example, the patient with backache. He will come to you, tell you, I have a severe backache, I couldn't sleep last night, and I'm worried that it is serious. The doctor, he may have the same problem. He will say, oh, don't worry, I have severe back pain, sometimes I can't sleep, but you see, I'm working now, I have no problem. The intention of the doctor is to reassure him. But telling your own story and telling the patient that you are strong and you manage to come and do your job and you are a very strong person, you can neglect the pain and do your job, it is not helping at all. As if you are telling the patient you are spoiled, you are overreacting. Look, I am the reference. I have pain and I continue working. Who told you that you are the reference? Every patient has his threshold of pain. If your threshold of pain is high, this is very good. Alhamdulillah, you are excellent. But the patient, his threshold of pain is low, and he has the right to complain about his pain. Okay? Don't tell your story and don't consider yourself as a reference. Okay. What are the myths and what are the truth about empathy? Some of you, they may say, my patient, they know how much I care for them without this nurse. I don't need to name the emotion and show understanding and respect and show support and to ask them to talk about his emotion. They know I am empathic. They know I am a very nice person to them. I care for them. But the truth, patient don't experience our care and compassion until we give voice to it. If you don't say it, how they feel it? They don't have the ability to read what is in your heart. You need to voice it. Other myth, some doctors, they may say, my empathy will not change patient's suffering. If he is suffering, he couldn't sleep, or he is depressed, or he has problem at work, my empathy will not change anything. I will tell you, acknowledgement of suffering and allowing ventilation, we said this before and we continue saying it, just allowing ventilation, allowing patient to talk about his suffering, is reassuring and improving doctor-patient relationship. So all what you need to know is ask him to explore more, to tell you about his suffering and give him empathic listening, active listening, all that what he needs from you. Just to listen to him, okay? So try to use your ability. You are able to help the patient just by good listening. Use your ear and patient will be very happy with it. Okay, this is some examples of in Arabic for what can you say to help your patient. هحاول أسوي إلا أقدر عليه عشان أساعدك. اطمن العلم اتطور وهناك في حلول كثيره لكل مشكله. ما خلق الله داء الا وله دواء. كل هذه جمل, all these sentences are give support and reassurance to your patient. Okay, and remember قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم, لا يرحم الله من لا يرحم الناس, ومن اعطي حظا من الرفق فقد اعطي خيرا كثيرا. والرحمه والرفق, empathy is not something in your heart, it is something you need to show it to your patient. It's not enough to keep it in your heart. Okay? Now we are going to see the role play, and bi-iznillah, you will see how easy and spontaneous you can learn it and you can do it with your patient. Okay?
الموضوع مزعجك كثير
صراحة دكتور. أنا هنسلي متزوج من فترة، جربت العلاجات ما فارت معايا.
أيوه
حاسس إنه ما في أمل. ما
لا لا تقول كذا، الأمل في ربنا كبير. كل اللي عندهم صعوبة في الإنجاب بيكون عندهم نفس الشعور. أنا متفاهم ومقدر مشاعرك، لكن الحمد لله العلم تطور، كل مشكلة ولها حل.
شاء الله.
حاب تكلمني إيش حاسس دحين؟
والله دكتور زي ما انت عارف انا دحين سلي متزوج كم سنة، زوجتي سوت التحاليل وكده الحمد لله امورها كلها كويسة.
الحمد لله.
خايف انه اكون ظليمة معايا.
كيف؟
صراحة احنا من اول مخططين انه من يوم ما نتزوج نخلف. اي ما شاء الله تحب الاولاد في العيلة، ما شاء الله التعامل مع الاولاد مرة كويس. لما تجلس مع الاولاد وكده بترجع البيت زعلانة.
ايوه
انا صراحه لما اشوف الناس عندهم اولاد في عمري الموضوع مضايقني صراحه.
لا تقول كذا، خلي املك في ربنا كبير.
ان شاء الله خير.
ان شاء الله.
كيف اقدر اخدمك؟
والله دكتور انا محول لك على اساس اعمل اشعه مقطعيه للراس، عندي صداع.
سلامتك.
الله يسلمك.
حكيني أكثر.
يعني عندي صداع تقريبا له يمكن أسبوعين زي كذا.
أسبوعين؟ أيوة.
والصداع هذا يروح ويجي.
طيب.
يمسكني كذا في مقدمة رأسي، أحسه زي الضغط، شيء كذا يضغط على رأسي.
سلامتك.
الله يسلمك.
كابتن أحمد، أنت إيش تتوقع سبب الصداع؟
خايف يكون شيء خطير.
شيء خطير؟ لا سمح الله. زي ايش؟
سرطان، شيء زي كذا.
بعيد الشر عنك.
امين ان شاء الله.
انت ليش فكرت كذا؟ شكلك منزعج.
والله دكتور يعني الموضوع قلقني صراحه، يعني خايف. انت عارف سرطان وزي كذا وشغلي واكيد الموضوع مزعجني.
معليش انا متفهم وضعك. والله انت في مركز حساس واكيد ان موضوع الصداع هذا ممكن يضايقك شوي. بس ان شاء الله ان نتساعد ونلاقي لك حل
ان شاء الله باذن الله.
بس يا ليت يا كابتن احمد انك تكلمني اكثر كذا عن احاسيسك.
دكتور يعني الوالد متوفي وانا الوحيد اللي عيل الاهل، يعني الوالده والاخوات في البيت، فاكيد لازم اقلق. يعني انا خايف لا سمح الله يكون شيء خطير واموت، ومين حيبقى للاهل؟ يعني مين يصرف عليهم؟ من يجلس معاهم؟ فالموضوع مره يعني ما انام في الليل، على طول افكر في الموضوع. مره موضوع يعني قلقني صراحه دكتور.
اوكي وي موف ناو تو ستيب 5، ميكينج يوز اوف فيزيكال اكزامينيشن. Four things we are going to talk about: how to make your examination gentle and non-threatening, how to use it for exploration of emotion, and how to use it for reassurance, and how to use it to enhance positive messages. Okay, you see how physical examination is useful, and you can do much more than detecting physical signs. You can do all these things. Okay, how to make it gentle and non-threatening. First, try to take patient permission. You tell the patient, I want to examine you now. Okay? Inform him, what are you going to examine exactly and why. So you tell him, I want to examine your abdomen. I want to examine your back, whatever. So he can expose the area which you want to examine it. Okay? Try to break the ice and put patient at ease, because when a patient go to the examination couch, he will feel anxious because this is the complete weakness where he is helpless. just laying down on the examination couch, and you are going to tell him take a breath and hold your breath, move right, move left. He's completely helpless. He's like a model between your hand. So try to make it simple, make it easy for him. Try to break the ice. For example, talk about anything away from his illness. For example, about the weather. Explore minimal body part as needed, nothing more. I think especially in our community, especially when you are examining a female, even if a female examine a female, you should take care of this. Explore the minimal things, okay? The minimal part of the body which you need to examine. Okay, prepare the patient for possible pain or embarrassment. If your examination you think is going to be painful, tell the patient, I'm sorry, you will feel pain. And when you prepare the patient for pain, usually the patient tolerate the pain better. And they may tell you at the end, it's not painful, I'm okay. While if you didn't tell them that your examination is going to be painful, they will shout and they will say, this doctor is not sensitive, okay? And apologize for any discomfort or any potentially painful examination. To tell the patient, for example, I'm sorry, it's going to be painful. I'm sorry, it might cause some discomfort for you, okay? All these things show the patient how sensitive you are, how caring you are, okay? Inform him when to finish, and thank him for his cooperation. So you tell him, now we finish, you can put on your dress. Other things which you shouldn't do it at all, never, never ask a history of any physical symptoms while you are examining the patient. For example, while you are hearing his heart sound, you ask him, is anybody in the family has a heart problem? What do you think the patient will understand from these questions? He will understand as if you are hearing something abnormal. Or try never to ask about physical symptoms while you are examining the patient, because he is very suggestible at this time, and anything you say, it will go directly to his unconscious and will cause him more anxiety. Okay? So this is the 8 tips which I like you to remember whenever you examine a patient, to make your examination more gentle, non-threatening. Okay, how to make use of the examination for exploration of patient feeling? We said in the non-verbal communication that the way we dress, the way we appear, all these non-verbal things affect the way we think. So when the patient on the examination couch exposed for physical examination, this body exposure, it will make his feeling more ready to expose his feeling and his emotion. So if the patient, he didn't talk much while he's sitting, you are taking history from him, maybe he's going to be more ready to talk about his emotion while you are examining him or after physical examination. So take this opportunity and let him talk about his emotion. Never miss this opportunity to listen to the patient during and after physical examination. Next thing, how to use physical examination for reassurance. We examine a patient, he's on the examination couch. Usually patient watch doctor face. They are very anxious, waiting for any cues to calm down. So take care of your facial expression while you are examining the patient. Try to show reassuring messages whenever possible. For example, smile if it is appropriate. In general, doctors need to pay attention to their verbal and non-verbal communication during physical examination. It will convey reassuring messages and to convey reassuring messages as much as they can. How to do it? Try to keep eye contact as much as you can. If appropriate, smile. Smiling is very reassuring. If there is no need for physical examination, at least touch the diseased part of the body. Or at least take the patient pulse. Because the patient needs to feel that he has been touched. Because as I told you, the patient complained, this doctor, he didn't touch me. If the doctor didn't touch the patient, patient feels sad, feel he's not taken care of enough by the doctor. You need to use the your magical power, the power of touch. Okay? How to make use of physical examination to enhance positive messages? Again, patient on the examination couch feel weak and maybe helpless. This makes him more suggestible. You need to use this situation when the patient becomes very suggestible to use it for the best interest of your patient. How to use it for the best interest of your patient? They call this situation the consultation power or the healing effect of touch while you are touching the patient. Smart doctor can take the advantage of this psychological situation for the best benefit of their patient by giving positive suggestion, reassuring suggestions, or counseling suggestion. For example, you want the patient to quit smoking. When you mention this while he is on the examination couch and he feel helpless and very suggestible, you tell him, Alhamdulillah, your examination is okay, but I need you to stop smoking. His unconscious is going to be very ready to accept this suggestion. And his compliance will be more, and his reassurance will be more. So give reassuring messages and give advice and counseling messages. See what are the myth and truth about physical examination. Some doctors, they may say, physical examination just for detecting physical signs, nothing more. But we are telling him physical examination is opportunity for reassurance. Some they say painful or humiliating physical examination is not doctor's fault. What can I do if the examination is painful? It's not my responsibility. But smart doctor can make it less harmful. Why not? You can try it just by telling the patient, I'm going to do this examination. It is painful. I'm sorry for this. This preparation will make it less painful. Now let us go to the role play and you will see how we can do the physical examination with less harm and we use it for the best advantage for our patient. Okay?
أخي أبو سليمان، الآن أنا أبغى أفحص بطنك. لو تكرمت تفضل لغرفة الفحص جوا، بس أبغى منك تكشف لي بطنك كامل وتتغطى بالشرشف بعد إذنك. تفضل. عسى بس المكيف ما مضايقك أبو سليمان؟
لا الحمد لله كويس.
طيب الحمد لله. أنا حبدأ الآن في فحص بطنك. أعذرني لو حطيت يدي على مكان ألم ولا شيء وألمتك.
مسموح يا دكتور.
الله يعطيك العافية. أنا آسف، معلش.
مسموح يا دكتور.
الله يسلمك، بس ما شاء الله يظهر لي الأمور مطمئنة الحمد لله.
والله يديك العافية.
بس والله يا أبو سليمان تحتاج أنك تنزل وزنك، لازم تبدأ موضوع الرياضة كذا وترتب موضوع الأكل.
إن شاء الله.
اتفقنا؟
إن شاء الله.
الله يعطيك العافية، الحمد لله الأمور كلها مطمئنة، اللهم لك الحمد.
شكرا دكتور.
الله يبارك فيك. خلاص تقدر تلبس ملابسك وتنزل.